Good morning. A major police operation has just wrapped up at Liverpool in Sydney's southwest, with specialist officers surrounding a unit after reports of gunfire. Five people are right now in police custody. Reporter Hayley Francis has the story.
Well, residents here on Charles Street were told to stay inside their homes as heavily armed tactical police surrounded this unit complex around 2 this morning following reports of gunfire. A large area surrounding the complex was sealed off as the riot squad and police negotiators swiftly moved in. Within 15 minutes, police arrested a woman. A few hours later, 2 more women and 2 men.
It's dangerous, you know, like too dangerous. I'm scared. I'm scared every time, you know.
We didn't hear anything whatsoever. I just woke up with a whole street full of police cars.
Detectives searched a large area outside the unit block in bins, over fences and under cars, then a white truck, which became their main focus. It was seized along with multiple bags of evidence from inside. All 5 people who were arrested have been taken to Liverpool Police Station, where they're being questioned.
In developing news, police in Sydney have just charged 2 men in connection with an alleged abduction in the city's west. The pair is accused of abducting a man and woman in Fairfield in February. It's the 5th suspected kidnapping this year. 26-year-old Peter Wong was rescued in a police raid last month. Foreign Minister Penny Wong is about to launch a spirited defence of the AUKUS alliance with the US and UK. Political editor Charles Croucher is with me on set this morning. Charles, what can we expect?
Morning, Lizzie. This is the first time Penny Wong has spoken in such a public address like the press club as since the AUKUS agreement. She's going to, at the same time, from what we have seen in the excerpt so far, both promote the need and the importance of the Pacific region and the rivalry between the US and China there, while also playing down the idea that conflict is the inevitable consequence. The sole focus almost of the Australian government in the last 10 months has been on the Pacific. Penny Wong, as you can see, has been crisscrossing the Pacific, both visiting Pacific leaders and welcoming them here to Australia, trying to secure Australia's spot in this region as one of the powers. Of course, this comes at the same time as Australia signed on for the AUKUS agreement, for the nuclear submarine agreement with the United States and United Kingdom, with a real focus on China and a focus on the Pacific as well. The contrasting tides when it comes to our trade arrangement with the Pacific has played out at the same time, particularly with China. Right now, Mark McGowan is on his way to China on a trade expedition. At the same time, Penny Wong and Don Farrell, the trade minister, are working with their Chinese counterparts to try and return some normalcy to that trade arrangement and see China reduce the tariffs on some of our goods. As it stands, these two strands, the defence relationship and the trade relationship, have been almost operating on separate paths. That is unlikely to last, and at some stage they are going to intertwine. Penny Wong's words today will have a lot to do with how that plays out. She speaks in about an hour's time, Lizzie.
Plenty going on. Thank you, Charles. Well, there have been delays for commuters in Sydney today. Trains heading in and out of the city on both the North Shore and Western lines have been held up due to signal repairs at Wynyard. Commuters are being asked to allow extra time and use the transport apps to check services. A truck has caused chaos in Sydney's west this morning after it rolled over, spilling its large load of timber across the road in Wetherill Park. Drivers were asked to avoid the area while the truck was towed away. The accident caused significant delays during peak hour. A woman has been killed in a crash in Melbourne's northeast when her car ploughed into a tree. Emergency crews were called to Heidelberg West just before 9 last night after residents reported hearing a loud bang. The female driver died at the scene. 4 people have been killed and 9 more have been critically injured in a shooting at a sweet 16th birthday party in the US state of Alabama. More from US correspondent Alison Petrowski.
Well, the first of the victims in America's latest mass shooting have been identified. Phil Dowdell had been attending his sister Alexis's sweet 16th birthday. He was the local high school football star, set to graduate in a couple of weeks, and had lined up a football scholarship in Jacksonville. 2 other names have also been released, Kiki Nicole Smith and Sia Collins, all of those 3 victims teenagers. This shooting happened at about 10:30 p.m. local time inside the Mahogany Masterpiece Dance Studio last night in Dadeville, a tiny rural community in Alabama with a population of just 3,000.
Please do not let this moment define what you think about the city of Dadeville and our fine people. what we've dealt with is something that no community should have to endure.
Now, the Dadeville police chief was very vague in his press conference. He did not mention a suspect, he did not mention a weapon, and he didn't even call it a shooting. In fact, he referred to it constantly as an incident that happened at the party. At the moment, police believe there was some kind of fight in the lead up to the shooting, but witnesses say otherwise.
Yeah, somebody in there that had a gun. Somehow walked in with a gun and just opened up fire, you know, for no reason. You know, nice party, nice family, just one of them things.
US President Joe Biden has released a statement calling this latest shooting outrageous and unacceptable. He says Americans agree and want lawmakers to act on common sense gun safety reforms. A staggering new low for America overnight, 8 mass shootings in a period of 24 hours.
Victoria's Deputy Premier says tough negotiations with the city's airport have compounded difficulties building a rail line to the airport. Mark Santo Martino joins us now. Mark, the project's future is already under a cloud due to mounting debt.
Well, we knew that was going to be a problem, Lizzie. Not only is the federal government steamrolling towards a $1 trillion debt in the coming years, Victoria's budget isn't looking great either. We're on track for a $165 billion debt come 2026. Now, we've noted that those numbers could see major projects like Melbourne Airport Rail delayed. And today, our Infrastructure Transport Minister Jacinta Allen all but confirmed that herself. However, she's told the ABC it's not the budget that's the problem, it's Melbourne Airport.
Negotiations, particularly with the airport, have at times, as I've indicated, they've been a little frustrating. They've been challenging, and they have put real pressure on the completion date.
Money for this project was committed back in 2018 by Prime Minister Malcolm Turnbull, if you can believe that, Lizzie. The airport never wanted the design it got that you saw just before, which was a station above ground. They wanted it underground, like in Sydney and in Perth. We don't know whether that's part of the negotiations, but there's also a question mark over Geelong Fast Rail. These budgets can't come soon enough.
Mark Santo Martino of the Forest in Melbourne. Ultramarathon runner and former Liberal MP Pat Farmer has started his run around the country in support of The Voice. Mark Burrows is at the starting point in Tasmania for us. Mark, what's happened in Hobart this morning?
Well, Pat Farmer headed off on his run today, Lizzie. He started off at the Hobart Town Hall. There was quite a big crowd to see him off, including the Tasmanian Premier and Prime Minister Anthony Albanese. This is part of an ultramarathon that Pat's undertaking to support a yes vote in the upcoming referendum. He's got something like 14,500 kilometres in front of him. And it's all to provoke he knows a lot of people will be against the referendum, but he also wants to be, as he runs around the country, he'll be stopping and trying to explain his point of view, and he believes the referendum is the best way to secure a better lifestyle for First Nations people. As I said, he started at about 10 o'clock this morning, but not before Anthony Albanese had a few words to say.
In Pat's vision in running some 14,000 plus kilometres around this great nation over 6 months, 80 kilometres a day on average, every day, he is showing his commitment to reconciliation. I want you to show not only Australians, but indeed show the world that Australians are mature, mature enough to reflect on the last couple of hundred years of our history, to learn from the mistakes of our past and to move on into the future as one nation, one people.
It's quite remarkable. Pat is now about 10 kilometres down the road from where I am. I'm at a place here called Bridgewater, and he's running straight up to New Norfolk. He'll then make his way up the west coast of Tasmania, along the north coast and back down to Hobart before he heads off to Perth to start his leg there. A lot ahead of him. He'll start here in autumn, he'll run through winter, and he'll be at Uluru in spring, just before a date will be set for the referendum, Lizzie.
Mark Burrows there for us in Tasmania. A Melbourne cyclist has spoken out, saying he's lucky to be alive after he was struck by a car in a terrifying hit-run collision. Adam Hegarty reports.
Well, just hearing the details of this horrific hit run recounted has brought the victim, 59-year-old Robert Clark, to tears, supported here by his wife Donna. And this is the incident in question captured on dash cam video. This was Thursday morning around 6:40 a.m. on Douglas Street in Dandenong, and it shows that white Mitsubishi Lancer stopping for Robert on his bike, allowing him to pass, and then accelerating, veering left, mounting the curb, and then seemingly intentionally mowing him down. It then drives off and drags the bicycle, which has become mangled for several metres with it. Robert left pretty injured on the side of the road, thankfully surviving, but left with some pretty nasty cuts, bruises and grazes. Let's first hear from him and then the investigating officer.
I could just see things flashing past me as I'm tumbling, and then I stopped. And it was just this realisation, I'm still here. I think that's the first thing.
I think anyone that partakes in this particular behaviour is should not be on our roads, one. This sort of behaviour is dangerous, it's reckless, and it's just fortunate that no one was killed or seriously injured as a result of this.
The car in question didn't have number plates, so there is a possibility that it was stolen.